Good evening. Welcome to iFocus Lecture 98. Today is the second in glaucoma series and a very important topic, cunioscopy. Cunioscopy is extremely important in the diagnosis and management of glaucoma, and we have an expert speaking on cunioscopy, that's Professor Tanul Taza. I request Vanita to introduce him and then he'll start off with this lecture. Vanita? Vanita, you can introduce.
Thank you very much. A very good evening to all of you present here today. We do have a special guest, but as usual, we have our chair and co-chair, Dr. Harsh Kumar, and joining us from Delhi, and Dr. Pratip Vyas joining us from Indore. Our guest today, very special guest, Dr. Tanuj Dada, is a professor at AIIMS RP Center. He completed his undergraduation, post-graduation from AIIMS with flying colors and with lots of awards and achievements. I think quite a few people are aware of this. He has been in the forefront of research in glaucoma, and his special interest, which the world is taking note now, is the use of meditation as an ancillary tool in glaucoma. He holds and he represents India in various world bodies, including World Glaucoma Association, as well as the International Society for Glaucoma Surgery. As you all know, he's going to talk to us about cunioscopy. I think he is very well aware now that there are several postgraduate trainees who are in hot seats, and he's invited to ask them questions, making his talk as interactive as possible. Dr. Tanuj Dada.
Thank you, Dr. Vanita, for your very kind introduction, and thank you, Dr. Santosh, for organizing this fabulous PG education series. And thanks to Dr. Harsh and Dr. Pratip Vyas for being here. So today's talk will be on gonioscopy, and people on the hot seat should be concentrating on the slides. So Rolika Bansal, what is this slide on the right side, title slide, right side corner?
She may not be there at all. She's Dr. Santosh's fellow.
So what about Dr. Yashasvi?
Yes, sir. Sir, anterior chamber angle it is.
ये बताओ, ये जो slide दिख रहा है आपको, इसमें क्या दिख रहा है? ये modern art क्या है ये?
So the angle.
एंगल तो नहीं, ये क्या डायग्नोसिस बताओ, ये क्या है, ये एंगल ऐसा होता है, ये सब क्या है?
सर साइनिक,
ये क्या, ये वर्म्स है आई में, क्या है ये?
सर नो आइडिया.
नो आइडिया,
वो दिखता नहीं है ना, इसीलिए नहीं आइडिया.
सर इट्स एन आइरिडोडायलिसिस एट दैट एरिया.
मृतिका सेन है यहाँ पे? नहीं.
Yes, sir.
हाँ मृतिका, तुम हॉट सीट पे नहीं हो, मगर तुम पुराने रेजिडेंट हो, तो तुमसे पूछ लेते हैं भाई, तुम्हारा तो ग्लूकोमा में थीसिस था, तुम बताओ क्या है ये?
These are the ciliary processes.
Very good, very good. So this is a patient, post-traumatic patient who has got complete iris torn from the ciliary body. So you can see the ciliary processes. Okay. And here you see ciliary processes are detached from the sclera. So this is iridialysis and this is cyclodialysis.
Cyclodialysis.
Present here. So anyway, I'll start my presentation now. So this is actually a lot of images and videos which have been collected by the residents of RP Center. So this is our collection over last 10 years. So this lecture is dedicated and all the hard work of the residents of RP Center. So first important thing is that gonioscopy is hardly done. So I have seen in the clinic of patients who are referred to us, they have ophthalmic evaluation minus gonioscopy. So first question is that why do we need gonioscopy? So the primary purpose of gonioscopy is to distinguish between an open angle glaucoma from an angle closure disease. That is the primary purpose of performing a gonioscopy. So this is what denotes an open angle. That means mechanically, the cornea, trabecular meshwork is separated from the iris. So this is mechanically an open angle in which the trabecular meshwork is visible. So this is a wide open angle where trabecular meshwork is visible. You contrast this with this image and this ASOCT. Now the iris has come in contact with the trabecular meshwork. So the drainage angle is closed. So here you compare with this. Now iris has come in contact with the trabecular meshwork. So that is the primary purpose of gonioscopy, to distinguish open angle from angle closure. Now why it is important to distinguish? So these are, I'll run two videos simultaneously. So you can see, compare the superior video from the inferior video. So Mritika, you can help me with asking any of the residents to identify what is superior, what is inferior. Just speak out any name at random out of the people attending.
Okay, sir.
Otherwise, I will ask
okay,
you.
Okay, sir. No, sir. Dr. Sanjana, would you like to come online, switch on your video?
What is diagnosis of upper video? What is diagnosis of the lower video?
Unmute yourself, please.
So the upper video shows an open angle showing the ciliary body band with pigmented trabecular meshwork and scleral spur. And the lower video can be a occludable angle or it's appearing closed.
Very good. So if you learned this much, then this lecture is successful. Okay, I can stop here. So this is an open angle because you can see iris and then the ciliary body band is visible. And iris, ciliary body band, and then you have this white zone, that is the scleral spur, and beyond that you have the trabecular meshwork. So this is the pigmented part of the trabecular meshwork. So if the trabecular meshwork and scleral spur is visible, that denotes an open angle type of glaucoma. And if you see contrast with this, the iris is obscuring the trabecular meshwork. So this is angle closure, this is open angle. So that is the primary purpose of doing gonioscopy, to differentiate these two conditions. Now, why it is important, although the ratio of angle closure to open angle is 1:3, but if you see the ratio of blindness, angle closure has threefold risk of bilateral visual impairment and blindness as compared to primary open angle glaucoma. That is why you need to differentiate open angle from angle closure, because if you don't identify angle closure and you treat the patient as open angle, then very high risk of blindness in these patients. Then next thing is how to do gonioscopy. So when you are learning gonioscopy, you can start off with any Goldman 2-mirror lens, and you should do it in a dark room and have a small slit. When you put the small slit, 1 to 2 millimeter length, it should not cross the pupil because it will lead to artificial contraction of the pupil and opening up of the angle. So that will be a false opening up of the angle. So this is just a small video. You take a patient, you have put topical anesthesia. You can take a swab stick or with your thumb, you retract the lower lid and then insert the gonioscope. So you have to inform the patient that he'll have some pressure sensation. Okay, so just lower lid, you create a pocket and insert the gonioscope. You can ask the patient to look straight or above. So this is the technique of using the Goldman type lenses on the slit lamp. And this is the other lens. This is the indentation gonioscopy. So you have the Posner lens, which has a handle. and you have the Sussman lens, which is just the lens. So these two lenses are commonly used for indentation gonioscopy. So here you have a small diameter lens, which is placed on the cornea. No need for a coupling agent because it approximates the corneal curvature. And then you press the lens to push aqueous in the angle and open up the angle. So this is the lens used for indentation gonioscopy. These are the Posner or the Sussman lenses. And then the third type of lens, which is now becoming very important, is the Swan-Jacob lens. These are lenses used intraoperatively. So this is a patient of congenital glaucoma. And you have to tilt the microscope and you can see there is only iris visible. So there is a anterior insertion of the iris onto the angle. So none of the angle structures are visible. So this is the Sussman Swan-Jacob lens is used to see the examination under anesthesia. And you also require this lens to do any of the new techniques of minimally invasive glaucoma surgery. So these are the three types of lenses we are commonly using in our practice. So this is the fourth type of lens. This is the Kopay's lens. And you can view the angle with either a handheld slit lamp or directly under the microscope. So advantage is you can put this Kopay lens in both the eyes and you can compare one eye with the other. So this is examination under anesthesia being done and this is a handheld slit lamp. Now coming to the structures visible, as you saw in the video, you follow up from the iris, then this dark brownish reddish band, that is the ciliary body band. After that, you have this white zone, that is the serial spur. And then you have this area of the trabecular meshwork, which is the most critical part. Then the non-pigmented part of the trabecular meshwork and the anterior most is the Schwalbe's line or the starting point of the angle. So you have to identify the angle structures and write in your OPD card, what are the angle structures visible? Hamritika, any of the residents, what is the diagnosis?
Dr. Divya, would you like to take this one?
Yes, sir. It's an open angle, sir. As you can see, the posterior trabecular meshwork is visible.
Very good. So this is open angle because trabecular meshwork and underneath that the wide zone of scleral spur is visible. So whenever scleral spur is visible, that is absolutely an open angle. Very good. And what about this, Dr. Divya? What is this? What is the difference between this one and the previous one?
For here and manipulation, it is going to be open.
No manipulation. So here, yes. In addition to scleral spur, the ciliary body band is visible.
Band is visible.
So sometimes there is a confusion between this, whether this is angle recession or no. So many times, especially myopic eyes, this ciliary body band will be visible. It will be uniformly visible in both eyes 360 degree. Whereas angle recession, there is an irregular widening of the ciliary body band. So that is sometimes confused with angle recession. So this is a normal wide ciliary body band. Now, if you are not able to identify the angle structure, there is an important test you should learn, that is the corneal wedge. So basically, you make a slit when you are examining on the gonioscope, a 30 degree angulation of the slit lamp, you will see two beams of light. The first beam is from the corneal endothelium and the second beam is from the corneal epithelium. And where they meet, that is the Schwalbe's line or the termination of the Descemet's membrane. So here you can see this slit, corneal epithelium, corneal endothelium. And this, where they're meeting, this is the starting point of the angle of the Schwalbe's line. So if the iris is present anterior to this, or you're not able to see the apex of the corneal wedge, that means angle is completely closed. So if you are in doubt, you make the corneal wedge and that will help you identify the Schwalbe's line. Hamritika?
Dr. Ajiba? Dr. Ajiba, are you there?
Yes, ma'am.
What is your diagnosis?
So here, I think the angle is closer because the iris is at the junction of the corneal bits.
Anything else? Some very specific sign is visible.
So the double hump.
Double hump sign. This is sine wave configuration. So this is implies what? What is the diagnosis of
plateau sine wave? Iris.
Very good. So there is a prominent ciliary body pushing the iris. So this is the hump in the periphery, and this is the equator of the lens. So when you do indentation gonioscopy, if you see this sine wave configuration, that is typical of plateau iris. Now, what is the diagnosis of this case?
Dr. Shaina, are you there? Yeah.
Sample is.
Currently, I'm just wanting you to answer whether it is open angle or angle closure. That is enough for you. Just identify whether this is open angle or angle closure.
Open angle.
अब बच्चे ध्यान से देखो, ये आपका कॉर्नियल वेज है और यहाँ पे शॉल्बेज लाइन है. दिस पिगमेंटेशन इज प्रेजेंट एंटीरियर टू द कॉर्नियल वेज. सो ये शॉल्बेज लाइन है. सो दिस इज अ सूडो ट्रबेक्युलर मेश्योर. दिस इज अ पिगमेंटेशन मच एंटीरियर टू द शॉल्बेज लाइन. एंड वेरी राइटली यू सेड कंफ्यूज इट विद द ट्रबेक्युलर मेश्योर. दैट इज व्हाट मिस्टेक वी हैव बीन डूइंग. So that is the utility of the corneal wedge. So now you see the apex is here. So this is the Schwalbe's line. And the iris is covering all the angle structures. And this pigmentation is anterior to the corneal wedge. So this is not open angle. This is complete angle closure. And you have used the corneal wedge to identify this pathology. That is why it is very important. If you see pigmentation, don't take it as trabecular meshwork. Make the corneal wedge. And then you will be able to make out actually whether it is open or closed. Now, who will answer this?
Dr. Shohini?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, go ahead.
Sir, it is an open angle.
Or anything peculiar you see?
There is increased pigmentation of the trabecular meshwork.
ये क्या है? ये क्या दिख रहा है? ये foreign body ये क्या है? What is this thing?
Sir, samples.
So this is a open angle. This is a young patient. This is a prominent band like Schwalbe's line. Okay.
Yes.
So sometimes in juvenile glaucoma or young patients, you can see open angle, and this is a band like Schwalbe's line visible. Okay.
Okay, sir.
So now you have identified angle open or closed. This one.
Dr. Sheikh.
Ma'am, there is increased pigmentation of trabecular meshwork.
Which angle is this?
Sir, it's an open angle because...
Superior angle, inferior angle?
Sir, I can't comment on the side, sir. It is...
Always see the opposite angle, na?
It could be very inferior good, angle because it is highly pigmented. And
so
there is,
you see this, what is likely diagnosis?
Scleral spur, pigment dispersion syndrome, sir.
Very good. This one, Dr. Sheikh?
Dr. Abhishek? Dr. Sheikh.
Sir, there is increased pigmentation with fluffy, white fluffy material over the trabecular meshwork. Could be pseudoexfoliative syndrome, sir.
So both these are, you are seeing this This is superior angle. Dense uniform pigmentation in the superior angle.
Opposite.
So if you put a gonioscope and you see this dense uniform pigment in superior angle, diagnosis is pigment dispersion. So both these gonio videos show you pigment dispersion syndrome. And this dense uniform pigment on the trabecular meshwork is hallmark of pigment dispersion, and especially in the superior angle, because inferior angle you can have pigment due to gravitation. Superior angle, if you see this sort of finding, that is pathognomic of pigment dispersion. What about this?
Dr. Abhishek?
Dr. Abhishek hai ki nahi?
He's there, sir. Dr. Abhishek, please unmute yourself.
Sir, this is the angle closer. Because
angle closer kyun bol rahe ho, ye tumhe dikh raha hai trabecular meshwork to hai idhar, iske niche scalars par bhi hai.
Yes, sir, this is the trabecular meshwork.
Tumne isse pehle wali slide dekhi thi, kya likha tha?
Sir,
तुम कुछ कॉफी पियो भाई थोड़ी सी, ये देखो पिछली स्लाइड पे क्या लिखा था, सॉल्ट एंड पेपर एंगल पिगमेंटेशन. सो दिस इज अ ओपन एंगल, देयर इज इंक्रीज पिगमेंटेशन व्हिच इज इरेगुलर एंड इंटरस्पर्ड विद सम वाइट फ्लफी मटेरियल,
सूडो एक्सफोलिएशन.
सो व्हेनेवर यू सी दिस इरेगुलर पिगमेंटेशन with some white area, that is salt and pepper pigmentation of pseudo exfoliation. Okay.
Okay, sir. Thank you. Thank you, sir.
So now we come to
this is the
different. So, Dr. Abhishek.
Yes, sir. This is the peripheral anterior synechia. Is
very good. So here you see now, the iris has come in contact with the trabecular meshwork. This is trabecular meshwork on both sides.
Yes,
in the center, the iris is coming in contact with trabecular meshwork. Yes, so this is called goniosynechia or peripheral anterior synechia, hallmark of angle closure.
Yes.
And here you can see left half of the angle is open.
Open, and here is the
and right half is closed.
Closed, yes, sir.
This is trabecular meshwork, and here it is not visible.
Yes.
अब ये कौन बताएगा मृतिका, पूछो किसी से.
डॉक्टर अर्णव, डॉक्टर अर्णव आर यू देयर? ओके, आई डोंट थिंक ही इज देयर. डॉक्टर ईशा, एनीबडी एल्स हु इज ऑनलाइन? डॉक्टर अभिषेक, वुड यू लाइक टू टेक दिस?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, Dr. Arnav is here. Go on.
A closed angle with blotchy pigments at the Scholl base line.
So this patient has got, you can't say closed, completely closed angle, because here trabecular meshwork is visible.
Yes.
And scleral spur is visible. So there are areas where the iris is coming in contact with the trabecular meshwork.
Mm-hmm.
That is one sign. Second is irregular spattered pigmentation on trabecular meshwork. So this is a patient of primary angle closure. There is early synechia formation, and these pigments spattered on the trabecular meshwork indicate patient has had a previous attack of angle closure. And so if you see this in a patient, patient has to undergo YAG laser iridotomy immediately. This is a hallmark indication for YAG laser iridotomy, because synechia formation has started. And another patient you see here, the iris is getting attached to the trabecular meshwork, so synechia formation is occurring. Now who will tell about this? This is a specific sign on gonioscopy.
Dr. Yashasvi? please unmute yourself.
All of the hot seat people should remain unmuted, bhai.
Sure. Sir, it is angle is closed.
Very good. Aur batao. Ye kuch sign hota hai gonioscopy mein specific.
Sir, Fusey sign.
Bolo bolo, theek bol rahe ho.
Fusey sign.
Kya hota hai Fusey?
Sir, over the hill view you can get.
हाँ तो एक volcano Fuji sign होता है, so this is looking like a volcano and central crater, so this is a completely closed angle and when you get this sign Mount Fuji sign that denotes a thick anteriorly displaced lens, so this is a lenticular mechanism of angle closure and if you see underneath ciliary processes are visible, so Mount Fuji sign indicates that there's a lenticular mechanism. It's a thick anteriorly placed lens causing angle closure. Now, you people understood this in primary position, angle is closed. So now you have to answer the question whether it is reversible or no. So then you do manipulation gonioscopy. You tilt the mirror towards the angle being viewed or ask the patient to look towards the opposite side. Now you see primary position, trabecular meshwork is not visible. When you manipulate now, scleral spur trabecular meshwork has become visible. That means primary position angle was appositionally closed, but it is opening on manipulation. So patient is a primary angle closure suspect. There are no synechia. And this is now the Posner lens. So primary position angle is closed. Now we are pressing the lens, pushing aqueous, and now you see the serial spur becomes visible. So this is indentation gonioscopy. Primary position angle is not visible. You push the lens, press in aqueous, and serial spur has become visible. So this is used to distinguish appositional closure from synechial closure. Who will tell this?
Dr. Sanjana?
Sir, it's showing iris processes.
Iris processes. Bachche, tum log attention nahi de rahe ho hain.
This is the neovascularization of the angle, sir.
Haan, very good. Ye kaun bol raha hai?
Abhishek.
Dr. Abhishek.
मृतिका अभिषेक को चॉकलेट देना भी एक
अभी
आएगा हैदराबाद वेरी गुड अभिषेक दिस इज अ न्यूवास्कुलराइजेशन ऑफ द एंगल एंगल
यस
सो एनी पेशेंट डायबिटिक रेटिनोपैथी और सीआरवीओ यू मस्ट डू अनडायलेटेड एग्जामिनेशन ऑफ द एंगल सो दिस वाज फाइंडिंग वाज मिस्ड सो ऑन गोनियोस्कोपी यू कैन सी देयर इज अ इरेगुलर आर्बोराइजेशन ऑफ दीस वेसल्स ऑनटू द scleral spur. So any vessel crossing the scleral spur is pathological. So this patient immediately requires pan retinal photocoagulation. If you delay this, it will go into synechial angle closure and very bad neovascular glaucoma. So yes. Learn to identify the neovascularization of the anterior chamber angle. Any patient who has got especially vascular occlusions or proliferative diabetic retinopathy. So this is a neovascularization of the anterior chamber angle. Very critical slide for you to understand. And if you are not careful, few days later, you will see that synechia has developed. So this is a stage of synechial closure developing in a patient of neovascular glaucoma. Habi, what is this?
Dr. Devya?
Anteriorly placed the squalbus lens.
Diagnosis?
Posterior embryotoxin, axenphil rigor syndrome.
Very good, Dr. Devya, very good. So this is anteriorly displaced squalbus line like a band and you have iris attaching peripherally to it and this leads to choroptopia and polychoria. So this is typical of axenphil rigor anomaly. And this is the video of and patient axial trigger, you will see very anterior synechia formation, peripherally displaced iris attaching to anteriorly displaced ciliary body in a young patient. This is a 16-year-old patient. Very anterior synechia formation to the periphery of the cornea bilaterally. What is this?
Dr. Arnav?
Arnav ji, bataiye.
So, signs of iridotrabecular iris processes can be a case of sir, open angle glaucoma, maybe juvenile or primary open angle.
These are iris processes, okay?
Yes, sir.
We have to differentiate these from peripheral anterior synechia. So these are fine filiform processes. They will follow the contour of the angle and they will constrict on light stimulation. These are usually seen, even they are normal finding in young patients, but they can be increased in patients of juvenile glaucoma.
Yes, sir.
And Arnav, what is this?
So iridotrabecular contact, ITs.
This is not iridotrabecular contact. Mm-hmm. This is again, this is a 50-year-old patient. Okay.
Okay, sir.
So you see prominent Schwalbe's line. This is called anterior insertion of the iris. Okay.
Sure.
So this is hallmark of developmental anomalies of the angle. Okay. These patients have got very deep anterior chamber. So this is not angle closure. This is an anterior insertion of the iris. Okay.
Okay.
Who will volunteer for this?
Dr. Ajiba?
Is this any radio? Somebody said iridodialysis, somebody said angle closure, somebody said aniridia.
So there is iridodialysis for sure, along with visibility of ciliary.
कौन बोल रहा है तो पहले आपको आप identify करो अपने आप
को.
Sir, myself Abdul Aziz.
हाँ Abdul Aziz, you are saying it is iridodialysis.
With visibility of ciliary processes.
तो आपको मेरे को chocolate देनी पड़ेगी अब. ये रहा iris आपका, ये सब iris है.
Okay.
This is a rudimentary iris stump. So who gave the answer? Aniridia is correct. This is aniridia. There is a small rudimentary stump of iris which is causing angle closure. These are rudimentary ciliary processes visible. This is the lens visible. That is why aniridia is a misnomer. There is a rudimentary iris stump present. So this is typical case of aniridia. Rudimentary iris stump, small atrophic ciliary process is visible. Okay.
Okay.
And this is irregular widening of the ciliary body band. So this is post-traumatic angle recession. Irregular widening of the ciliary body band. Again here, you see ciliary band is not visible here. Ciliary body band is visible here. So irregular widening of the ciliary body band. And if you are not sure, you always compare with the fellow eye. So these patients require lifetime follow-up because glaucoma can develop after 10-15 years after the injury. So if you see this finding on gonioscopy, very important. And any patient who has got blunt injury to the eye, you must do gonioscopy after 6 to 8 weeks. And identify whether there is angle recession or no. Again, irregular widening of the ciliary body band. So these are all examples of angle recession. Haan, poochho bhi, Mritika.
There's Dr. a glass Shaleen? Piece. There's a foreign body in the angle.
Okay, Dr. Sanjana, yeah, you can go ahead.
There's a foreign body in the angle, so a glass piece.
This is a spectacle, broken spectacle in a somebody who was playing badminton.
So this case you had operated with me.
Yeah. You have attended previous class. Otherwise, this is very difficult to answer. So people have said this is express implant. Somebody said this is new MIGS device. This was a foreign body. And patient came to our casualty and he has self-seal perforation. He was sent away. That you are very lucky. There is nothing in the eye. And he came back with irritation, uveitis. And then gonioscopy was done. And this foreign body was there in the eye. Who will tell about this?
Dr. Shohini?
Dr. Shohini, koi answer nahi de rahe hai.
Yes, sir. Sir,
Dr. Shohini, bachche, aap kahan se ho? Kaun se college se ho?
I'm from Hyderabad, Shadan Institute of Medical Sciences, sir. I mean,
Haan ji, aap bataiye.
Sir, there is blood in the schlems.
Tumne isse pehle wali slide dekhi ki nahi? ये क्या है ये ब्लड ये इतना क्या मोटा ताजा चीज है ये तो ट्यूमर नहीं है ये
यस सर
यस सर
सर तो पेटेंट ट्रबेक्युलर ऑस्टियम से ट्रबेक्युलोटोमी ऑस्टियम
हु इज स्पीकिंग डॉक्टर
अजीबा सर
हाँ डॉक्टर अजीबा यू हैव गिवन एब्सोल्युटली करेक्ट आंसर वेरी गुड सो दिस इज सुपीरियर एंगल देयर इज अ क्लेफ्ट इन द स्क्लेरा So this is a patent trabeculectomy ostium visible. This is iridectomy. Okay. That you must learn to identify. What about this?
Dr. Ajiba?
Sir, the ostium is closed, sir. There is a...
Partial closure. So iris, this patient has developed shallow AC and iris has gone into the ostium. Okay.
Yes, sir.
That is causing high IOP, failure of trabeculectomy. So you must learn to identify the patency of the ostium, whether it is open or it is closed. And that can tell you the cause for failure. Ye kaun batayega?
Sir, silicone oil in the angle.
Aur kuch? Ye kya hai?
There is suture in the trabecular
trabecular meshwork. Sometimes you can see the architecture of the wound on gonioscopy. This is a suture. Sometimes there may be a leak from here. And this is, of course, more hyperoleon, emulsified silicone oil in the angle visible. तो जो ये बताएगा उसको ट्रीट दूंगा मैं आई विल गिव हिम अ ट्रीट व्हेनेवर ही कम्स टू डेली आरपी सेंटर
एनीबॉडी कैन टेक दिस क्वेश्चन
द आयरिस एनाटॉमी अपीयर्स डिफरेंट देयर आर नो क्रिप्स
मैं कुछ नहीं बोल रहा था मैं ट्रीट दे रहा हूँ तो मैं कुछ नहीं बता रहा था उन लोगों को अब तुम बताओ क्या है
Anybody else?
Patient has come. Patient is 25 year old. Has come in with 40 eye pressure.
Sir, is it unilateral?
Unilateral.
Eye syndrome.
Eye syndrome कैसे हो गया ये?
Maybe.
कौन सा क्या condition होता है? Patient has got 40 pressure, unilateral, hardly any signs and symptoms.
Ah,
very good. These are fine. You see this? Small pigments on the trabecular meshwork.
Yes, sir.
So this was a patient of Postman-Schlossman syndrome. Okay. अब ये क्या है अभी बताओ
द हाइड्रस इम्प्लांट
वेरी गुड सो दिस इज यू हैव टू लर्न इंट्राऑपरेटिव गोनियोस्कोपी बिकॉज नाउ लॉट ऑफ ग्लूकोमा सर्जरीज रिक्वायर You had left hand, you hold the gonioscope, and right hand, you inject these implants into the Schlemm's canal. Whether these implants are good or bad, that is separate lecture. But you must learn how to use interpreting the gonioscope to identify the angle structures. What is this?
Dr. Divya?
No, I have no idea.
Okay. Anybody else?
Indentation gonioscopy angle is being opened on maneuvering.
So this patient had come to the clinic and my resident got me, sir, this is a prominent Scholbe's line. Anterior display, prominent Scholbe's line. You agree, disagree?
Anybody can answer.
Batao bhai. So this is the video of the case. ये आपका जो दिख रहा था आपको ठीक है There was a broomstick injury. There was a broomstick in the angle, which is appearing like prominent Scholbe's line. So that is the utility of gonios. Sometimes you have a surprise. So you can see this big wooden stick lying in the angle, which was identified as a prominent Scholbe's line. So you have to be very careful because if you drop this, then it will go perforate the capsule and go on to the retina. Okay, this is your culprit. Then nowadays it is very important that you must clean the gonioscope and after every patient you can use soap and water and ideally during the COVID era you have to clean with 1:10 household bleach and you can also use 70% isopropyl alcohol wipe so that is a must nowadays after every case and finally to summarize Whenever you put a gonioscope in the patient's eye, you have to answer these questions. What are the angles structure visible? Is the angle open or no? Second question, does the iris touch the trabecular meshwork? If yes, what is the extent? Then, is there any evidence of previous iridotrabecular contact? That is in the form of pigment spattered on the trabecular meshwork. If there is contact, is it reversible or no? That means whether it is appositional or synovial closure. Then you have to comment on the amount of angle pigmentation and the configuration of the iris. Then whether there are any new vessels, especially pathological, crossing the scleral spur. Are there any prominent iris processes or is there an anterior display Scholbe's line or an integral insertion of the iris that tells you it's a developmental anomaly in the angle. Then you can also identify any abnormal tissue or a foreign body or post-traumatic cleft in the angle or an angle recession. And post-operatively, you have to answer whether trabeculectomy ostium is patent or no. And nowadays, you have to learn intraoperative gonioscopy. So what about this slide? Can anybody identify what is happening here? So this is a worm in the anterior chamber angle. And finally, after you have done gonioscopy, how do you report gonioscopy? So there are various theoretical classifications. I'm not going into that. You have to report in gonioscopy what is the posterior most angle structure visible. And for that, you should know something which is known as the Becker's goniogram. So you draw a circle and you can denote the outermost as a Schwalbe's line and then this pigmented part as the trabecular meshwork and the scleral spur. And then note down the areas of the pathology where there is pigment position, whether there is any blood vessel. So this gives an actual 360 degree view of the anterior chamber angle. And that is the ideal way to depict gonioscopy. If you don't have time for this, you should mention that what is the posterior most angle structure visible and whether the iris is in contact with the trabecular meshwork or no. So you have to distinguish whether angle is occludable or whether it is an open angle, because that determines the future course of therapy. And this is a free educational resource, WGA.1. So there is a basic course in glaucoma. This is free registration. There is no money in this. So you people should register here. And there are courses. And after that, there is a question answer. So this is on IOP, gonioscopy, perimetry, and examination of the optic nerve head. So these are basic modules which all postgraduates can learn. And this gives you a lot of videos on gonioscopy. So now you should go back and rehearse and see, go through this module. And then whenever you get a chance in the future, if you see a patient, you must do gonioscopy and at least learn to differentiate an open angle glaucoma from angle closure. So I think I will close here. And thank you for all the residents for very good active participation. And you could answer a lot of the gonio videos. So congratulations. And thank you very much to Dr. Mritika for handling this presentation in a very nice manner. So if there are any questions, very happy to answer.
Yes. So thank you so much. I mean, your resources related to gonioscopy, absolutely superb. I obviously noticed that most of it is with the two mirror because it's possible to take videos and photographs much better. As you can see in my background also, that's a neovascularization with a two mirror. It's that much more difficult to capture it with a four mirror, which is what, us glaucoma specialists would be advising most people to do because it helps in indentation and you can answer the question whether it is open or closed much better. And not just that, you can make out between appositional and... So before I actually ask our chair and co-chair to comment, I just wanted to ask you, do you have any experience of foreign body related to caterpillar hair?
No.
Because I came across one and it was so difficult. It just travels from the anterior segment to the posterior segment. And, you don't know what to do with it, basically.
Okay.
I would put that same question to the chairs and, of course, comments from each one of them, Dr. Harsh and Dr. Prati. Please go ahead.
It is absolutely, absolutely a phenomenal lecture. And... I'm for the first time in my life, I'm really happy sitting in the chair and not in the hot seat. It was so good. Tanuj, I would like you to tell them which gonioscope should they buy.
I would say resident, they should buy at least Goldman two mirror, because you know initially they have to spend time in the anterior chamber angle, put in viscoelastic and see in detail. It is very difficult to interpret unless you know. So I think initially in the training period they should buy at least two mirror Goldman gonioscope, because then they don't have to rotate. They can view the superior inferior angle. And then later on, once they learn good gonioscopy and they come into a glaucoma fellowship or they become glaucoma specialist, then they can go ahead and also additionally buy an indentation gonioscope. That is quite expensive.
Yeah, actually, there's not much of a difference of cost, but I think Tanuj is absolutely right that because some people may ask you this question in the PG exam, so you can, I think this is the correct answer to give to initially this, but ultimately, I think in practice, it is essential to have the foam mirror for the simple reason that you put the gel over there and the people get very, very upset. So it is, and it gives you indentation and you get used to it by the time you are already, if you have had a two mirror, and even if you're like we were in RP center, so those things are provided over there for you. But you have to buy your own gonioscope, be 100% sure about that. And I'll put some things in a different perspective because Tanuj has never been in practice. So if you are in practice and you miss an angle closure, you miss $5,000 doing a peripheral iridotomy. And second thing is that your entire course of action now is wrong because you have made an angle closure into an open angle.
Yes.
What Tanuj very clearly told that there is a 3 times chance of these people going blind and you are not aggressive enough because you have not picked up the diagnosis and this person will definitely go somewhere else and they'll pick up the things and say, oh, who's this foolish fellow who missed this thing? So let me be very clear. There's no confusion about this. Every patient that comes to your clinic, you have to do a gonioscopy. You have to have your own gonioscope. Okay, Prateep, please.
Yes, you know, Tanuj, wonderful lecture. I enjoyed it thoroughly. And I'm sure that the PG also must have enjoyed it thoroughly. Gonioscope is an indispensable tool. And everyone, whether you are a glaucomatologist or a general ophthalmologist, you have to have a gonioscope and you have to do the gonioscopy. Gonioscopy has lots of values. It has a diagnostic value. It has a therapeutic value. And you know, in many other conditions, apart from glaucoma, you put the gonioscope and you got to know that, oh, this is you know, something different. Like he said, that there was a pass in the angle. Sometime, you know, you have done the cataract surgery and the patient is having a uveitis, recurrent uveitis, and you put the gonioscope and you see a small piece of nucleus is over the angle. So it has a lots of value. So every single ophthalmologist learn to do the gonioscopy and they must procure a gonioscope when they enter into their own practice.
What about the in COVID times, how are you going to sterilize, Tanuj? What is the protocol in your place for sterilization of the gonioscope?
Actually, sir, frankly speaking, we are not doing much gonioscopy in the COVID era. It is very scary for us spending time with the patient on the slit lamp. But I think after every patient, we are cleaning with the sterilium solution or isopropyl alcohol. And then after the end of the day, then they are kept in the household bleach 1:10 solution.
Okay. So even a soap and water, soap water wash can work very well at times if you are doing.
Sir, it was okay up to the COVID era because now again, I think they are shifting that it is not due to fomites and it is due to aerosol. But you remember last year there was such a human cry. So,
so 1:1000 methylate, we can keep it for 5 minutes.
Yes. That is also okay.
I think so. If we give them one or two things, then it can be 1:1000 methylate and keep it.
Yeah. The only thing is that if you put alcohol, you should give adequate drying time. So I have seen some residents, they clean the alcohol and then put the gonioscope and patient developed epithelial defect.
Yeah, that is.
So you must dry, let it dry and then only use it.
Right. So can we just move on to the questions now? Because there are quite a few. The first one is, how many clock hours of neovascularization in the angle
would you say is significant?
Even one clock hour.
How many clock hours?
There's no how many. If you detect new aspiration in the angle, even if it is just one clock hour, it is significant.
I think this is being put across this question because quite often you may see an aberrant iris vessel, which may be mistaken for neovascularization. And therefore, we are talking about how many clock hours.
Yeah, I think if you have a patient who has got a predisposed condition, such as diabetic retinopathy or vascular occlusion, and then you see these new vessels which are arborizing on the trabecular meshwork in a regular fashion, so that is a clinching diagnosis.
So any comments, Dr. Harsh or Dr. Prateep?
No, I think again the same thing that once you are doing a gonioscopy, you are actually seeing the whole patient as a whole. So you will be looking at the fundus, you know whether there's a CRV or BRV over there and things like that. So I think the whole thing has to be taken in totality. If there's a history of trauma, then you are looking for that, for the broomstick that you wouldn't have otherwise picked up.
But surely there is in the broomstick injury, there is a full thickness corneal scar, no?
Yeah, that's right. But anyway,
you... In the limbus.
Okay, so... any comments, Dr. Prateep?
Yeah, you know, you have to learn to differentiate between the NVA and the abnormal vessels. You know, the NVAs are very fine filiform vessels, and invariably they cross the Chalbes line, they go anteriorly, and obviously there is an associated pathology in the eye. So every PG have to learn to differentiate between these two conditions.
Right. The next question is, in which cases would you prefer gonioscopy after dilatation?
No, I don't think there is any preference for gonioscopy after dilatation. Ideally, you should do gonioscopy undilated only because that is the best way to actually see the angle structure in the physiological position. So there is no point in specifically dilating and then doing the gonioscopy.
See, what I would add here is that in a comprehensive examination, if you found that the AC was deep enough on one Herrick's, hopefully you've done one Herrick's, and then later on went on to find that the disc is suspect, then I suppose you should retrace your steps, do a gonioscopy and dilatation as well as next visit, when the patient is undilated, to be absolutely sure. I have faced that kind of situation with respect to fellows and PGs. So, I'm speaking from experience. Anyway, so the next one then is, how long after TRAB would you do gonioscopy?
No, I think after TRAB, you will do gonioscopy if you find that the intraocular pressure is rising and the TRAB is not functioning. That would be indication because you have to identify what is the cause of the failure of TRAB. So that is when you would do a gonioscopy if you find that the TRAB is failing or the IOP is rising.
But would you refrain from doing it in the first week, second week, say for instance?
I think first 2 to 4 weeks, I would not do a gonioscopy. And especially you can't do a Goldman type gonioscopy because there's a chance of infection and it will press on the bleb. So mostly it is done in the after, say, 4 to 6 weeks. If you find IOP is rising and you have to identify whether the iris has gone and blocked the ostium or some other complication has occurred. So not in the very early postoperative period.
Vinita, I'll just, because there's something coming in my mind because the timing.
Sure, go ahead.
I'll forget it later. Because one thing I think we must emphasize is that gonioscopy, even when you have written at it is an open angle, you must repeat gonioscopy 6 monthly or at least 1 yearly interval. I've had Dinesh sending me a patient back and saying, Harsh, please have a look again. And the angle is closed now. So please.
I think so actually, That's a question. Is it mandatory to do gonioscopy every visit? Yeah. Or when would you recommend? Yeah. So that was one question as well. Yeah. So just as well you answered it. But do you do Dr. Tanuj or Dr. Prateep have any alternate view?
No, annually, annually is a good thing. Annually, you must repeat gonioscopy.
Only the two things. Number one, you know, you have to put the gonioscope in every patient where you suspect glaucoma or you have diagnosed glaucoma in every single patient. And number two, whenever you have decided to do a serial gonioscopy, yeah, either 6 monthly or annually is good enough. No doubt. And about this dilatation, you know, leave it to the only expert. For the PG's teaching, you must know that, you know, gonioscopy has to be done in an undilated patient. Okay? Mm-hmm. And in a normal illumination. It should not be too dim or you should not throw too much of light over the pupil. Normal room illumination.
Uh-huh.
But suppose we dilate a little bit and then we do a gonioscopy and we find that the angle now is closing up totally.
Yeah, Harsh, you are 100% right. I said that it is for PGs. But you know, semi-dilated and dilated, you will leave it to the expert. Once they are into their glaucoma practice, then they will do that practice. But yes, sometimes the semi-dilated gonioscopy, yes, it may give some good information to you.
Yeah, I think, Dr. Harsh, what you are saying, other way around, it is helpful. If patient is dilated and you do gonioscopy and angle is open, then yeah, it rules out angle closure.
Yes, that is also there, very much.
Yeah. See, also, I think I would like to add here that even if you have done a gonioscopy and you do it annually, any time in between if the pressure is not controlled, just to be sure that you've got the diagnosis correct, one should fall back upon gonioscopy and make sure that there is no angle closure. Because combined mechanism does exist. You may start with a borderline, but an open angle, and that may close later on during follow-up period. So perhaps that also should be emphasized. There is a question, I don't know whether it's a question or a comment, but it says, kindly emphasize on biometric gonioscopy. I have not heard that term. So
no, there is a way in which you can make a graticule and, you know, measure the angles, but practically, I don't think that is required because this is a qualitative examination. Yeah. You're not trying to measure the angle.
Yes.
That is more for research. For clinical purposes, I don't think it is required.
Uh-huh. Yeah. And one more which asks whether accommodation can cause change or cause angle opening.
So when you're doing gonioscopy, I think that is a factor you cannot... that doesn't come into play when you are interpreting the gonioscopy. The only thing is that the illumination has to be controlled and you should have a dark room. Other factors you can't control.
Yeah, well, you do ask the patient to look straight ahead. So patient is not accommodating. That's one. Accommodation is a very transient phenomena. So, you know, I don't think that comes into account.
Yeah.
Of course, pilocarpine use of regular use of pilocarpine will change the angle structure, you know, will cause opening. I'm sure the person who's asked this question is aware of that. After how many weeks of injury is gonioscopy done following blunt trauma?
So ideally, it should be done after 6 to 8 weeks.
Okay. Any alternate comments? Or would you agree with that?
Yeah, fair enough. Let the thing subside.
Good enough.
Let the practice guide.
Patient may not have high FEMA, may just have a little bit of red eye.
The problem is that, you know, if you put the gonioscope and you do a little bit of manipulation and if there is a risk, then the patient angle vessels may bleed. So that is a risk. So that's why it should be preferably avoided for 6 to 8 weeks.
And you're not going to gain anything by doing it early.
Absolutely.
Right.
No, what I find, and this is a practical problem, is that patients then don't come back.
No, that you have to warn the patient.
Yeah. That if you don't do it when the opportunity presents itself, yeah, I'm not saying do it when there is active hyphema or inflammation or whatever, but you know, if the patient is under treatment, most likely in the majority of cases it subsides. And you know, from that point onwards, I find that patients actually don't come back.
A small recession would not progress. Should not worry about that.
No, no, no. It's not about progression. It's about the optimum timing.
No, you can. I think for any trauma patient, you have to scare them a little bit that you have to show us every 6 months, because so many patients I've seen who suddenly come back and say, we had had trauma 10 years back. Nobody told us we have to have a regular checkup, and they come with such high pressures. So I think that way we have to get them back.
Okay, fine. Now a few questions on angle closure. In angle closure, should dilatation be avoided if examination of fundus, dilatation be avoided if examination of the fundus is essential?
You can do the dilatation after doing the peripheral arytotomy.
Exactly. It doesn't take long, but you know, that might be a practical issue in some places, and that's why the question has been.
Yeah, it should be avoided, you know, unless you do the prophylactic peripheral arytotomy. Because if you are diagnosing a patient having a angle closure suspect, then how can you dilate, you know?
Dr. Arnav, he asked this question. He's one of the hot seaters. In case of acute angle closure attack, apart from the medications, can we directly go ahead with indentation using gonio lens?
That's like we used to tell that in
the thumb.
The thumb. And, you know, with the thumb pressure, instead, if you have an indentation thing, you can put the pressure suddenly.
It doesn't work.
Rarely. Once in a blue moon. It doesn't harm you anyway.
Yeah, it doesn't harm you doing that.
Too congested it is, actually. Anuj, have you done it? Quite painful.
No. I have read about it, but I have practically never used it.
Yeah.
But actually, you know, Tanuj, I think there is a problem that sometimes we fall into the trap of doing only things with that we have been taught. And I think RP Center has a classical, this thing what Dr. Ramanjit or Dr. Sood taught us. So we are following those things. And so like I keep fighting with somebody tells me that you do paracentesis for acute attack. And there are so many people who actually tell us, but we never did it in our center. So I think there's a trap over there. Vanita, what is your opinion?
Now the era has changed in RP Center. Now it's Tanuj era.
I don't use it in congestive attacks because such, you know, an acute attack like that is painful for the patient. So, you know, it's more appropriate to go ahead with the oral acetazolamide and mannitol if indicated, you know, all those kind of things, and get topicals in quickly as possible and control the pressure. I feel it's very painful, and the patient will not come back if one gives so much pain when the patient is already in pain. Mm.
Actually, right. Tell if the patient, if you are in the periphery, in the like DHC or someplace where no modality is available, there to break an attack, early attack, this is theoretically possible. But I think
once
the patient comes with the acute attack, high pressure.
I had taking a lecture in Alvaro somewhere, but a doctor told me, sir, I did this and nothing was working, mannitol, topical, dimox, nothing was working, and we didn't have any even laser at that time. So we did this and suddenly the attack broke. So theoretically it is a possibility.
Yeah.
Yes.
Right. What about a paracentesis?
Dr. Vanita, you are giving a postgraduate training. So I think...
Yeah, let us
take the gonioscopy.
Okay, fine. So the last question then, what is retraction gonioscopy?
What did you say? What is?
What is retraction gonioscopy?
Retraction?
Retraction?
Yeah.
I'm not aware of this. Yeah.
Let that person enlighten us.
this is a question that has come through the chat box. So,
no,
I'm not
spelling
sure.
Spelling mistake to nahi hai.
What is near it also? I can't imagine anything else.
Reflection.
Okay, Divya in the hot seat, she's sending a question in now. Does coupling fluid refractive index affect the optics of gonioscopy, and what is the preferred fluid?
Oh my God. So, Tanuj?
No, I don't think once you become experienced in gonioscopy, I think
it doesn't matter.
Yeah. It doesn't matter much. But I think if you are postgraduates, I would prefer methyl cellulose because then the air bubble doesn't come in.
Right.
So, but you must warn the patient, and because it will cause sometime blurring of vision. So that is why what Dr. Hirsch was saying, that if you can avoid coupling fluid and learn to do over time indentation gonioscopy, that is better because that doesn't disrupt the vision of the patient.
Okay, I think we are done with the questions. Some final thoughts from all of you.
A great experience for us. I think I have really learned something today in addition to what my original knowledge was. And thank you very much.
For being there. Thank you.
Thank you, Tarun. Wonderful talk. Wonderful.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Yep. Like I said, you know, as soon as you finish, a superb collection of videos, of photographs, of, you know, multiple pathologies in the gonia. I actually find that quite often when one is a little bit in a dilemma as to what type of glaucoma it is the gonioscopy which clinches the diagnosis.
Definitely.
Quite often. And yet it is one of the clinical examination that people don't want to do.
Yes.
So, you know, it must be everyone's experience that gonioscopy has not been done and the patient has been diagnosed as POAG, whereas obviously, you know, it turns out to be otherwise.
Yes.
Especially when the pressure is really, really high, one and asymmetrically so, one has to be so much more careful. My mantra now, how I teach fellows and residents, is that every patient in front of you, you should say, I have to prove that this is not angle closure. And that's when you will learn how to actually correct diagnose angle closure.
Yes.
But thank you so much. I you know, for a really, really wonderful talk. And,
thank you.
You know, very interactive. I'm sure everyone enjoyed it, not just the hot seaters, not just us here, but all those watching on, you know, various platforms, YouTube and online other platforms as well. And as usual, thank you to our chair and co-chair for sharing valuable pearls in gonioscopy. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Good night.
Bye-bye. Thank you. Good night.
Next Wednesday, we have disc evaluation by Dr. Harsh Kumar.
Oh, yes, of course. Sorry. Yes.
I start reading after.
Yes. Sorry. Okay. Yes.